Because now I have the opportunity to tell all of you how much I really enjoyed grading your essays this semester. A lot of you shared personal thoughts and memories or experiences, and it was really fun to read, and I really appreciate all the work that you guys put into your essays. Tonight's guest speaker is Ron Pierce from Montana Fish, Wildlife, and Parks. I wanted to introduce Ron because he's my restoration hero. I worked for him three summers ago. And I really, it was my first experience seeing how restoration monitoring happens. Ron is from Wyoming, grew up here in Montana. He actually went to University of Montana, was in our wildlife biology aquatics program. So he studied fish right here on our campus. Somewhere in there, he went and learned how to make wine in France for a while, so he's been around and done some other interesting things as well. Ron went to work for FWP in 1988 at Fort Benton, working on prairie river systems. In 1989, he transferred to the Blackfoot River and started that monitoring program, which has been ongoing for over 25 years now, and I'm not going to steal any of his thunder talking about that right now. His responsibilities include restoration, applied research, overall fish management. He is a certified professional with the American Fisheries Society. He's published multiple papers on applied on-the-ground restoration. And he actually took this class in 1986. So without further ado, here is Ron Pierce.
How's that? Can you guys hear me okay? In the back? We good? Okay, Tracy, Natalie, thanks. It's a pleasure to be here. Gosh, it's been a long time, 29 years since I've been back at this class. You know, and I guess 29 years, yeah. What I want to do is talk about history, some history since I left this school. You know, we've got the Wilderness Act, which is 50 years old now. We've got another anniversary up the Blackfoot, and that's the start of the Blackfoot River Restoration Project, which is about 25 years old right now. So I'm going to start today's talk with some history. We're going to go into some restoration. We're going to tie private lands to wilderness areas. We're going to look at some data from across the basin. And I'm going to try to tell what I hope is a good human story, because this restoration, this fish thing is one part of the story, but there's a really strong human side to this story too, which is really important. And we couldn't do the work we do without having the people in the background helping. And we'll touch on that theme too. That's the first part of the talk. The second part of the talk, I'm going to take you up into the wilderness country, up into the Scapegoat wilderness. And that's... we're going to talk about this area upstream of the North Fork Falls. We're going to try to talk about something that may or may not happen in the future. It's an idea right now, but it's a fisheries problem that we've identified in the wilderness. And we want to, you know, put that out there, float that one out there, and we'll see where that one lands in the future. But it is an interesting talk. We'll start first with this outline. We're going to talk about native trout. We're going to talk about problems afflicting native trout. Then we're going to go on to some other restoration things. First thing we'll do, though, is we'll get you all on the map. And so here's the Blackfoot watershed in west central Montana. This is the Continental Divide. Everything that drains into this area west of the divide flows this way. Everything on the east side goes that way. I think you know that. The thing that I think we're going to touch on more than anything else in this conversation is this country right up in here, this high country north of the Blackfoot River. That's the wilderness area. That's the forest area. That's the second part of the talk. We're going to focus on the low elevation stuff and some of the connections between that high country and that low country. This river begins right here at the mouth of Anaconda Creek and Paymaster Creek, and it flows 132 miles west, almost due west to the valley of the Clark Fork, where it joins the Clark Fork right here. Tonight, we're right there, the University of Montana, right where that little arrow is located. One thing you need to know when we're talking about biological processes and these landscapes which change is that there's a lot of different land ownerships. There's a lot of management philosophies on the landscape. We've got everything from the Forest Service wilderness you see up in this high country here. We've got the surrounding Forest Service land. We've got patches of state land, BLM land, and all this white stuff, all this low elevation white stuff, that's private land. And so when we're talking about some of the fisheries things, we need to recognize that, you know, the landscape changes a lot. The issues that affect fisheries are a function of how people choose to manage the land. And so not everything is protected, that's for sure. In places like this, we've got a whole host of issues in the down valley direction. Kind of get you tuned into the country a little bit. We've got some nice photographs of the country. These are some of the mountains looking north from Kleinschmidt Flat. That's Ovando Mountain. That's the native lupine on Kleinschmidt Flat. We've got a lot of prairie pothole country, which you don't see a lot of in western Montana outside of the Blackfoot and maybe the Flathead Valley. This is some of the water from the North Fork. We'll talk about the North Fork in detail. You can see the blues, the greens, the reds. This is belt rock geology. It's fairly unique to this part of the country. It gives these streams this really beautiful look. And so that goes back to, gosh, that rock is a billion years old, but it's interesting country. It's pretty country. It's got a lot of resource values. So here are a couple of three photos of the Blackfoot. This is the lower river near Johnswood. This is the middle river up near Ovando and the upper river near Lincoln. And I show you these pictures because we're going to actually look at some data from these three monitoring sites. These are nice pictures of the country, but these are also places where we electrofish for population estimates, where we gather data, and we're gonna look at a lot of information, a lot of data. A lot of the data that you're gonna see tonight comes from these three locations. Okay, and the way that we collect that information, that fisheries data, is with an electrofishing boat. And so this is an electrofishing boat. We shock these rivers at high water. When the fish are pressed in up against the banks or in the vegetation, they're out of that heavy current in the middle of the river. They move right into the shorelines. And so we can float these rivers at high water with an electrofishing boat. We can put a small amount of electricity in the water. And this guy here, Michael Davidson, in this case, nets the fish. We get him in the boat. We anesthetize the fish. We work the fish. We collect a lot of data. You're going to see a lot of data from these three sites. Another thing about this landscape that we work in, this area is prone to a lot of natural disturbance. I love this photograph up here. This is the Canyon Creek Fire looking west from Silver King Falls in 1988. This was one heck of a fire, and we're going to circle back and talk about that when we get up into the Scapegoat. This is also a sediment-rich system. It's geologically young. Landforms are 10 to 12,000 years old. There's a lot of sediment entering the system. This is an earth slide into the Blackfoot River in 1996. The area is prone to drought. We'll look at some data. We'll talk about drought. We'll talk about temperature warming. And this is a picture I took in 1996 after what I call the Blackfoot Glacier went down valley. And what this was, it was a giant ice flow. It was 15 feet high by the time the thing hit the lower river. And it killed maybe two-thirds of the fish in the river when this ice flow went down in 1996 in the lower river. So it was a significant natural event. So we've got that in the background. of this area. We've got two native fish that we are managing for. One is bull trout. This is an ESA listed threatened fish, and it's a native to the Blackfoot Basin. And the second fish is the West Slope cutthroat trout. Those are our two native trout. We also have a native mountain whitefish. We're going to talk about these two fish in this conversation tonight. And one of the things I want to mention is these fish understand that natural environment really pretty well. They have developed a lot of adaptations to the high country, to the intermittent reaches, to the disturbance. They utilize the whole valley. They do pretty well on the landscape, unless they come up against certain things, that I call, the legacy landscape or aspects of the human landscape. And thank goodness these are legacy issues for the most part. One of them is the Mike Horse Mine in the very headwaters of the Blackfoot River. This is a picture that our guys took in 1975 when a tailings dam formed of contaminated mine tailings blew out and contaminated the upper river, led to a significant fish kill. That is only now getting cleaned up. This should be a good year up at the Mike Horse 40 years later. We've got lots of other issues in riparian areas, irrigation impacts. In the case of this picture right here, you can see, how fish, bull trout, in the case of the North Fork, could move up valley, upstream, but as they come downstream on their out migrations, you can see how they would become entrained in these ditches. It was a big problem. They're all screened at this point, but we had all kinds of these on the landscape 25 years ago. And then we had certain timber harvest practices too, which people don't do anymore, but we still have a lot of the problems on the landscape. And so part of what we do is I think we're janitors, to some respect. We clean things up. We try to, fix problems. And that's what I've been doing for the last 25 years. So by 1998, we know that the Blackfoot River was in trouble. Everybody knew it. Anybody who knew the river knew that the fishery was in trouble. And so we got together with Trout Unlimited in that year, and we started baseline studies. And after 2 years of investigations, what we really found with that was that there were three really big things that we needed to focus on if we're going to bring the river around. And the first one was to get a handle on the regulations. You can see this fellow right here with that big bull trout, or way too many of these ended up on the grill. Okay, and that was an easy fix. In 1990, we changed the regulations to catch and release basin-wide. That was the easy one. Probably the most difficult one was dealing with this. Here we are 40 years later, and we've still not dealt with that one effectively, the Mike Horse Mine blowout. And the third major problem was the degradation of the tributaries and the effects of degradation on the river. And so one of the problems was easy to fix. The other two were difficult. This was more of a political issue dealing with this. The environment wasn't right in Montana to do the cleanup. What we did starting in about 1990 was go to work on the tributaries to see if we could turn that river around. And so I'm going to start with a little data from 1988-1989. And so at those three monitoring sites that you saw photographs of, the lower river, the middle river, and the upper river, this is species composition. The percent of fish in the sample that we collected in the electrofishing surveys from 88 and early 89, and what they show, those blue and red bars, was that the native trout in the river comprised anywhere from about 1% to about 9% of the total trout community. And those were really, really low numbers. That's an oversimplification of the full data set, but the bottom line was the native fish were in trouble, especially we thought in the upper river. Okay. So what we worked on about that time was a restoration process. Okay, I'm going to take you through that now as we lead into how we fix some of these problems in the tributaries. One thing I want you to get out, and the students better write this down, and that is this is an information-based discipline. You have to collect data. You have to understand what you're dealing with in this restoration arena. I mentioned it's a private land social endeavor. We're going to talk about that, and then we're going to lead into the prioritization of work. This is a I know you guys like flowcharts. A flowchart that we put together that we try to use to talk about the restoration process. And really, it all begins up here with data sets, fish population data, habitat data. We look at the treatment areas that we're moving into, and we also collect reference reach information, habitat data, fish population data. And write that down, reference reach data, because we're going to come back to that one. That one is really important. And what the reference reach is something that's ecologically functioning, that's geomorphically stable, vegetatively stable, without direct human impacts, that we can compare the treatment area against. And I'll get into examples of that. But if you have this baseline and if you have information, you should understand what the limiting factors are. And limiting factors we define as anything that keeps the population of fish below its full biological potential. Okay, we're talking about human-induced limiting factors when we talk about restoration. That brings us into the prioritization, the establishment of goals and objectives. Objectives should be quantitative, okay, and they should help you meet that goal. If you have this kind of information at the front end of the project, you're going to have a lot easier time with your design, with your fundraising, with your permitting. If you go right into this stage of things and say, hey, we got a problem and this is it, without any of this other information, you're probably going to get bogged down in the process somewhere. You may not get your permits, you may not get your funds, you'll probably have a sloppy design. And so I push this because this is really, really important, and you'll see examples of this as we go through this discussion. Once we do project on the ground, we move into the monitoring and the adaptive management and the evaluation aspects of a project. And everybody in fisheries or restoration, you know, should be versed in the value of post-treatment work. It is really valuable. Most people don't do it, which is too bad. And anyway, that takes us back here. Hopefully you've met the goals and the objectives of the project. If you haven't, well, you may end up somewhere back in this cycle. But if you go through this project and if you understand the resource, you're going to get where you want to be. And so this is the nature of the beast. Anybody who's doing good restoration has to understand this process and has to understand how to collect the data. One of the things that we did that I thought was really good, when we had the 2 years of data that came in, was, you know, we had to communicate that to the public. We had to describe the problem. If you can get the public behind you, if they recognize that there's a problem, if you can do it with the universal language of mathematics and numbers, you're going to have a lot easier time of convincing people of the problem and moving forward. This handsome devil here is Don Peters. He was the biologist in the Blackfoot in 1988. He's the guy who hired me, and he was really good at communication. You know, I was kind of gung-ho running out there trying to get stuff done. He was always, slow down, let's talk to the public first. And he was very good at convincing the public that there was a problem, and that helped get people behind the river restoration effort. I think he was the first one to coin the term the Blackfoot Challenge, also in a 1991 article in Montana Outdoors. And the Blackfoot Challenge has since turned into more than just a title of an article. Has turned into a very effective watershed group that does a lot of good things, which were outlined in this article about how do you put the pieces of the river back together and how do you engage in that social environment in order to do that. So over the years, what we've learned is, you know, we're working with people. You get them behind you, you can do a lot of things. If you don't have that information and if you don't have that problem statement, you're probably going to be in trouble. So here's a picture working with the kids out of Greeno, the Greeno school. We work with kids. We try to take the landowners along on these restoration efforts. This is an educational effort as much as it is a restoration effort. And right now we're working with the second and the third generation of landowners out there, and it's really great. Working with Paul Daniels quite a while ago, his son Ty, he built one of the first fences on Montour Creek, and so then this is Wyatt Daniels out of Helmville, part of the team. Fundamentally, data collections are what we do as fishery scientists. This was our first graduate student, Tim Swanberg, in 1996, doing a bull trout telemetry project. And you can see that little antenna coming out of that bull trout. We do strange things to fish. We put radios in them. We suture them up. We turn them loose. We track them. Gosh, look at here we have Tracy here. She was the last one to run a telemetry project for us in 2011. And she worked on West Slope cutthroat trout. part of the data that we get from these kinds of information, these telemetry studies, is the life history, the movements, the spawning areas, the habitat use, that kind of thing. And so with this telemetry information, part of what we've learned in Tim's Swanberg study, for instance, is we can radio fish in the lower river. And every one of those fish took us right up into here. Those red dots are spawning areas for bull trout. Okay, so then we move up valley and we do another telemetry study here, and we found every fish there went to this location, which was interesting. Then we do another study and we find that, you know, that the Clearwater River system is a little bit different. But the point being, with the technology and the telemetry that we have, we can really understand how to connect these river fish, these adults in the river, to their spawning tributaries, to their natal streams. And that's really important, because what we'll do is we'll combine that kind of data with electrofishing data, backpack electrofishing data. These are the guys in 1988. Ron Snyder and Dave Dixon, and since that time we have, I don't know, I think we have 500 or 600 sampling locations on 180 plus streams. We've got lots of fisheries information out there. So we can combine these movements of fish with this kind of thing, and it really gives us an enormous amount of information that we can use to begin to talk about how to bring this river back. What we found through these studies over the years was there were about 90% of the streams had some human-induced fisheries impairment to those streams. Very few were not altered. And those alterations and those impairments take all kinds of different forms. We've seen this before. You can see the fence line contrast, lots of culverts. Culverts are a problem because they're fish passage barriers. You're not going to get a fish jumping from here into here and negotiating a high-velocity perched culvert. And that's especially going to be the case in the spring, because cutthroat trout, which is the most abundant fish in the basin, migrates at spring when the velocities are very high coming out of places like that. Lots of channel alterations on 52 streams, irrigation impacts, not just dewatering. This causes an entrainment issue, loss of fish down the ditch, plus we've got a fish passage barrier there too. So those kind of things all you know, can lead to fisheries declines, and you know, they're all restoration opportunities. So, you know, with this kind of information, what that allowed us to do was build a prioritization matrix where we included all of the rivers, we knew the life histories, we had information from all of the tributaries, and we were able to develop a methodology of prioritization of the tributaries for the purposes of recovering trout populations in the river. Okay, so this is a river restoration program, but to restore this river, we've got to work in the tributaries. And what you see here, the high priority streams are primarily the larger tributaries coming out of the north. That's because native trout, bull trout, and west slope cutthroat trout drive the prioritization process essentially. A lot more weight is given to these fish, and so the priorities for restoration are mapped there, and those are our bull trout streams, as you might remember from the telemetry slide. We also add social and financial considerations into this prioritization, but we try to keep it based on the resource and based on the real needs and the indicator species like native trout. So, what do we do? We're going to go into, you know, the nuts and bolts of on-the-ground fisheries work at this stage. Whenever we do a stream restoration project, any major project, we always begin with a fisheries baseline, a pre-treatment survey. And so here we have Craig Podner and Ryan Nidecker, and this is a data set from Chamberlain Creek. And what this data set tells us, when we see a trend going like this in the down valley direction, is that there's probably a problem on the landscape. And sure enough, there was, and we'll go into it. But these areas would be the treatment areas. This would be a reference reach, okay? We talked about reference reaches, trying to bring these populations, these environments back up to reference reach condition. And so to do that, we'll often go out and do habitat assessments. We'll measure channels, we'll measure flow, water quality, sediment. We'll look at spawning sites. We'll look at all the irrigation infrastructure. We'll shock the ditches. We'll find out what's down there. We may do whirling disease studies. We do a lot of investigations trying to find out what it is that's keeping these populations down out there. And so we're measuring these things biologically with fish population surveys, but what we're doing really to turn this around is habitat-based, okay? It's working with the habitat. This is one of the first projects that we completed in 1991, I think it was, on Rock Creek, okay? And this was Rich Thuma, and this is, you know, we've done a lot of this. We've taken machinery into the channels, and we've reconstructed these channels, trying to restore the natural morphology, the habitat features of these streams. This is one technique. I think we've worked on about 27 streams right now. We've been busy doing this. In some cases where the riparian area has been over-harvested, we'll actually add wood back into the stream to diversify the habitat, to create the pools, the rearing areas, the tailouts for spawning and those kind of things, if it's deemed to be a limiting factor. And we certainly have those on the legacy landscape. I think going at least into the 70s, people were removing wood from streams. In the case of Gold Creek, they would bucket up into 8-foot lengths, and at high water, that wood would just blow out of the system. And you lost your habitat complexity. You're down to a riffle. We had a 3-mile riffle in this stream when we went in 1996 and decided, you know, to put wood back in. We did that with excavators, heavy machinery. We do a lot of fish screening, a lot of fish ladders. These are places where we've identified problems associated with irrigation. This is on Cottonwood Creek. This is a Dave Rosgen design. Anybody interested in restoration will know that name. What I like about this particular irrigation diversion is you set it at the riffle crest. The invert, the throat of this is at the elevation of the riffle crest, and a riffle is a steep bed form, and so what this does with this U-shaped design is it elevates the water at this location. This is about 3 feet higher here than it is here. We put a little fish ladder in here. We reinforce that structurally. There's no maintenance associated with it. In order to get the water, all you have to do is unscrew that valve, you know, a really easy, low maintenance diversion structure. This is new technology, actually, in terms of fish friendly irrigation structures. This is a fish ladder, and this is a middle generation. We're going to talk about these again. What these do is they keep fish out of the irrigation ditches, okay? So in the case of this one, the head gate is right here, water's coming through. This paddle wheel turns a set of gears, and it pushes these brushes back and forth across this screen. The water passes through the screen. The debris and any fish go out this bypass. Okay, these are self-cleaning, self-operating, kind of high-tech fish screens. They work pretty well, take some maintenance. We do a lot of in-stream flow enhancement out there, too. I think we've worked on about 24 streams so far. This is a picture, you know, prior to water. Here's the post picture. You know, this is important not just because it provides habitat for rearing fish in the tributaries. You know, there are fish passage issues, there are flow issues, water quality issues, all of that associated with in-stream flow enhancement. So we look at that pretty seriously, and it's a big part of our program. Trout Unlimited, Western Water Project especially, is good at placing these negotiated in-stream flow arrangements on the landscape with private landowners. Riparian revegetation is a big part of what we do. I think most of you guys know the value of riparian vegetation for fisheries. It's bank stability, it's shade, it's nutrients, it's, you know, basic habitat forming processes. We do a lot of this fish passage at culverts. I don't know how many culverts we've worked on. I think we've worked on 38 streams, maybe at least 100. 100 culverts have been removed and bridges built. This one's on Poorman Creek, which is a bull trout stream. You can see that's a pretty small culvert. You know, this is a $100,000 project right here. These things aren't cheap. But we have the programs. We've built those over the years. Grazing management is a big part of what we try to do. Whenever we do a restoration project, we need to manage that area for the recovery. Usually that means coming up with an alternative grazing system. And so we have people who help with that. We don't want these streams, a restored stream like this, going back to that. And that's what will happen unless you deal with the source of the problem. And you know, in this case, it's intense grazing pressure. So coming up with strategies that take the pressure off, that allow these streams to function naturally, is really a big, I can't tell you how important it is. It's really big in working landscapes where these riparian areas are intensively managed for livestock production. We've done a pretty good job. Here's something that the Blackfoot Challenge has really worked with. These are conservation easements in 1996. I think we had about 2,000 acres in that in 96. Here's what it looks like in 2014, that private land, that red. Most of that private land in the Blackfoot now is under conservation easement. This is the most recent easement. This was a TNC purchase of the remaining Plum Creek land. It just was completed less than a year ago, and that was 118,000 acres itself. And so I think part of what we're seeing through this history is you know, we've gone from a commodity-driven, utilitarian landscape to one that has a lot more conservation landscape. And I think the landowners and the managers, they see it, they see the value of it. Still a working landscape, but it's not going to turn into the Bitterroot. One of the things that these easements do is protect the land from subdivision, and so the wildlife habitat, the rural communities, the ranchers, all of that kind of thing. They're essentially, those lifestyles are protected with these conservation easements. And I think that's one of the reasons that a lot of these people enter into these arrangements. So this is a map showing our high priority streams with FWP funded projects over the last almost 20 years. And you can see those green triangles. We apply our work on the priority streams, which is good. That's why we prioritize, okay? So all of these streams to the north are our primary bull trout streams. We've done a lot of work there. This map is only about half complete because it doesn't include projects that we weren't involved in. And there's a lot of projects from the Fish and Wildlife Service, from Trout Unlimited, from the private landowners, and others who have done work out there that isn't on this map. But we all try to use the same prioritization, and that's the value of having a prioritization that's been vetted through our partnerships, is that, you know, when we come up with projects and money, we put it to where we have the projects. And if there's a competition between a high and low priority project, we're going to try to put that money, you know, where we think it'll do the most good. Adaptive management, we've learned a lot about that, you guys, I tell you. So looking at it from an irrigation perspective, I put this diversion on Blanchard Creek in about 1990. It was our first water lease in the state of Montana. We had a fish ladder over here, but this concrete diversion, these bars in the middle were too high. What they tended to do was trap debris. We had the channel blow around the structure. We said, well, we're not doing that one again. We came up, we started working with Daniil fish ladders, you know, with collapsible braces, thinking, okay, all I got to do is collapse the brace and all the debris will go downstream and we'll get over this issue. Anyway, we weren't seeing the maintenance that we needed, you know, for this one, and that's when we went to this structure. This is maintenance-free. This is a maintenance-free structure. It's easy to work with, but it took us a while. It took us 20 years to figure out, you know, some of these issues. But adaptive management is vital out there. Same with fish screens. This was a fish screen I put in on a major ditch about 1990 or so. It did not clean itself. It plugged very quickly. We replaced that screen with this screen, which is still working today. And it's that self-cleaning screen I was telling you about. This is our third generation fish screen. This is what's called a Coanda fish screen. And this is so simple. I tell you, I wonder why someone didn't think of it before. You got to go through this series, though. And what the Coanda fish screen does is it shears water. In the case of this diversion, It shears the water, sends the water to a ditch. All you have to do is open a valve. It's a wedge wire design, and so I'll pass this around. You take a look at that. The flow goes down where that arrow is pointed, and with that wedge wire design, it actually shears, in some cases, large quantities of water, and it sends it downstream, and that's it. That's all it is. It's not been approved by, say, you know, NOAA or some of those, you know, federal fish projects, but it sure works pretty well, and it sure takes the maintenance out of a lot of these structures. And so that's been part of our learning curve, you know. Adaptive management with grazing, too. We've tried grazing systems, you know, that don't work worth a hoot. This is a fresh restoration project, just got the piss beat out of it by cows. And so, you know, we are putting in more tanks and more fences and more of that kind of thing, too, as, you know, as we learn how to work across this landscape of mixed private ownership and public ownership. Not everybody thinks the same. And that's why adaptive management and monitoring is really, really important. This is a picture I took in 1989 of Chamberlain Creek. Remember that plot of that fish data where we went from really high numbers in the reference reach to very low numbers? Well, it was below this where we found those really low numbers. That's what it looked like in 2014. We've done a lot of projects out there with this one goal in mind, okay, recognizing that each project requires its own individual treatment depending on what those limiting factors are. Okay, you guys with me? Good, okay. What does it mean? Bottom line issue. Okay, this is a 20-year study that we completed. We published it a couple of years ago. This looks at the reference reach data against the treatment data. This is all log transformed data, and what we've seen here is quite a bit of variability, but a flat line reference condition. This is the mean. You can see the treatment data. It increases actually surprisingly fast if you get these restoration projects done. I think if you do them well. The other thing we've learned at the basin scale is that in terms of native trout response, we've seen these broad increases in the prior graph. What this shows is that most of the real measurable response is occurring in the up valley direction. Okay, so this is the closest thing to instant gratification that you're going to get in the restoration world, going from zero fish up to a reference condition, near reference abundance within a couple of years. And that gets back to this, the replacement of this crummy structure with this Rosgen design diversion. We've screened the fish, we put the water back in. You know, we've got downstream dispersion of the fish into the treatment area within a couple of years. We're right up here. Okay, the best bang for the buck, if you can do it, is is fixing irrigation systems in the Blackfoot. This is an interesting data set because this is in the mid to upper valley. This is Nevada Spring Creek. Before picture was over widened, it was pretty beat up. We reconstructed the stream using the techniques we talked about. This was interesting. For the first 5 years, we saw an increase in non-native trout, brown trout here, and then these things went down, and then we saw the native trout come on, which is interesting change in the community. The community flipped. And we think that had to do with the restoration of a nearby stream, which provided a recruitment source of cutthroat trout and water temperature reduction and habitat improvement. And so this explains some of that, that increase in the upvalley direction in the native fish that we talked about. This is a reconstruction of a Spring Creek study. This is a 14-year study looking at some pre-treatment data set against the reference mean, okay? And what we see here is long-term increases. When you reconstruct a stream and you start from scratch, these things can take at least 10 years to reach some level of equilibrium. And I don't think we've reached that point out here. We still have a trend that goes like this. We're starting over. And that makes sense. When you just put water back into a stream where the habitat features and the fish population is there, you know, can respond quickly. When you have to start over, it can take a long time. And that's the message on this one. Those green bars versus those green points and those red points. This is also an experiment of using wood for habitat diversity in a deep, narrow stream. Okay, so where we saw the wood, where we used the wood, we generally saw higher numbers of fish, more juvenile fish, and higher species richness in the sections with wood than in the sections without wood. And that's what that data is saying, and that's published. You can take a look at that. It's out there if you're interested in restoration. This is an important slide because what it shows is a significant temperature reduction. We talk about a lot of global issues, anthropogenic warming. Here's the control on the North Fork. This is one of our best bull trout streams. And this is the treatment area before and after. And you can see that maximum daily temperatures have dropped from about 15 and a half degrees C to about 12 and a half degrees C, which puts it right into the thermal niche for bull trout. This is really, really good temperature reductions using groundwater. Groundwater is important for anybody interested in temperature reductions in streams because groundwater assumes the ambient annual temperature of your area versus, you know, the seasonal and elevational fluctuations that we see in these mountain ranges associated with weather systems and climatic conditions. So groundwater is in this country is 44, 45 degrees Fahrenheit year round. And so if you can use that temperature regime and put it into the surface in spring creeks and upwelling areas, you can actually do something that's good to offset anthropogenic warming. It's an area of restoration science that's developing right now. We've talked about the tributaries. We've talked about a lot of data. One of the things that we use to measure bull trout abundance on the landscape is we count reds, and a red, R-E-D-D, is a name of a spawning nest. And so here we have a couple of fish, a couple of bull trout on a red. This is the nest. And what we do is we count these reds. You can see that it's a lot brighter than the surrounding gravel. You can observe these things in September at the end of the spawning season. We can count them. That gives us an index of population abundance. So these are our primary bull trout streams for bull trout of the Blackfoot River. We started here, regulations went in 1990. Boy, things went great. You know, we started restoration, we screened a lot of those canals. Then we hit 7 years of protracted drought. And it's like, wow, look what happened. You know, our red counts dropped by about half. We crawled out of that hole and we're up here now. What this tells me, you know, I hope this isn't necessarily a index of future, but these fish are stenothermic fish. They need that cold water. They're really subject to, protracted drought, especially in an environment where, you know, not everything is functioning. This is some data from the lower river. Remember those pictures from the lower and middle river? This is the rainbow abundance and biomass graphs. Look where we started here. Look at that. How are those trends? You gotta like that stuff. If you like cutthroat trout and restoration, this is a bottom line issue. This is really good stuff. You can see where we started, and I don't see an end in terms of where these trends are headed. And I think a lot of that's restoration related. We continue to work on those priority streams for those cutthroat trout and bull trout, and it's playing out nicely. Remember that graph where the bars, we had 5% native trout here, we had 9% here, we had 1% here. This is what the data looks like 25 years later. We've got a lot more green and blue, a lot more bull trout and west slope cutthroat trout. Anywhere from about 25 to 40% of the community is now back in native fish. We need to thank our bios. I'll get right to you, Vicki. Who've done a lot of this work. We've got a lot of local leaders who've done a lot of this work, and a lot, you know, got a lot of people in the background. And I'll take a couple of questions. Vicki?
Were those averages from many tributaries, the trout per mile bar graphs that you were showing, averages?
This one?
Were those averages from many tributaries in each of those?
This is for the Blackfoot River. This is the main stem Blackfoot River. Okay, this is the lower river, the middle river, and the upper river. Yeah, yeah, from those three photographs. So these, no, these are individual surveys. We do the survey every couple of years in that electrofishing boat. And so these are the results over the entire monitoring period.
So most of your work is in the tributaries, but you're seeing a response in the main.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, the tributaries is where the spawning and rearing occurs. We're trying to get that, those tributaries connected so that we can build this broader population. These are all migratory fish in the Blackfoot River. So these are all fish coming out of the tributaries. Any other questions?
Who funded the majority of the restoration projects that occurred in the tributaries?
Boy, I don't think there's any one single funding source. There's a lot of funding sources. We have a program, FWP has a program, the Fish and Wildlife Service has a program. We have people in Trout Unlimited who raise money. We have this list. Yeah, it's a long list of supporters.
Are there any negative impacts of the electro-shopping practice?
Not if it's done right. And so what we try to do with this electrofishing is we use what's called smooth DC. If you use if you use the wrong form of electricity, you can stress the fish. If you shock fish when the water is warm, you can hurt the fish. If you shock fish with the right electricity, we usually run about 3 amps, which is a very, very small amount of electricity. And all it really does is cause the fish to swim to the anode where you net it out quickly, put it in fresh water. We anesthetize the fish. We collect data, we put it in fresh water again, and we turn it loose. If you do it right, very, very minimal impact. If you do it wrong, yeah, you can hurt the fish.
How long does that process take?
You have to work in the fish?
Yeah.
From the time we stop the boat to the time that we work the fish in it, we may have 50 fish in the tub. It will take 10 to 15 minutes. It's kind of a little assembly line where you're working really fast, measuring fish, recording data, moving fish. It's a little process. Not very long. The idea is to get the fish in fresh water and turn them loose as soon as you can. All right, gotta move on to phase two of our talk tonight, okay? Okay, and this one is the idea I mentioned. Okay, second part of the discussions up here in the wilderness. You can't have a wilderness issues conversation without a real wilderness project. And so here we are up in the North Fork of the Blackfoot Basin up in the Scapegoat Wilderness. This is our little universe as far as this study goes. This is how we get up there. Get on a mule, get on a horse, take a ride. One thing when you think about this country is some of the slides you're going to see, all this gray area that you see up here, this was the Canyon Creek fire. This was one heck of a wildfire. Frank probably remembers those days. It was the fastest moving crown fire on record in North America, post-European settlement. According to the reports I saw, 300 foot flames, and you can see that it's coming west. I wouldn't have wanted to be in that lookout tower, personally. And this is a picture of the landscape after the fire. It was a very hot fire, according to the people that I talked to. There were fish kills throughout the headwaters of this area, according to the Forest Service and the bios who went up there immediately after. I'm going to talk about this area here, those yellow dots, our fish population monitoring sites that we've established in the wilderness. Okay, so this is very headwater areas up in the Scapegoat. We have a set of falls right here. That picture you saw between the falls and the Blackfoot River is about 30 river miles. We have another drainage just to the west, to the northwest of the North Fork. This is called the Dry Fork, and it is indeed dry, a little over 3 miles. It's a perched alluvial glacial valley, and so the water seeps in and the stream goes dry. And that's important for reasons I'll get to in a minute. This is the Natural Falls, just opposite of the Dry Fork. It's a hanging valley. I don't know how high it is. We estimated it at about 50 feet. It's a great
It's a beautiful waterfall. It's tough to get to. It's a natural barrier to the upstream movement of fish, okay? You know, and so what we're talking about in this part of the project is, you know, talking about something that's new, a new type of restoration. And the reason that we can have this conversation is because we have a barrier falls at the bottom end of this system. I'll explain that in more detail. Okay, so this is distribution of rainbow trout in the Blackfoot Basin. Rainbow trout is a low elevation fish, okay? They were stocked all over the country into the 70s, all through this area. They've settled into the lowest elevations. These are the spawning and rearing tributaries. This is the uppermost spawning tributary to the rainbow trout, the Blackfoot River, with two exceptions. One of them is Nevada Creek right here, where stocks of rainbow trout were placed in that reservoir, and they took there, they're reproducing there. And the second one is up here, up in some lakes where they were planted, we think starting at about 1900, and that allowed this area, you know, to go rainbow trout, you know. What's interesting here, we don't have the lakes. Up here where we have the refuge areas, the lakes, those fish managed to take it. So they have taken up in that high country. And that was a deliberate action 115 years ago when the U.S. Bureau of Fisheries started taking fish and planting them all over the West. State of Montana got into that in the 30s and planted something like 500,000 plus fish up there. The outfitters got into the act. We don't know what happened here. We don't have records for that. The Wilderness, the Wilderness Act was enacted in 64, the Scapegoat in 72. That's where our fisheries surveys fall in this timeline, and we really don't have a good sense of 100 years preceding. There's no data. There's no records. So it's brand new stuff. One of the things that we're finding is that up in this area, it's, you know, it's over 70% rainbow trout genes in the population now. That may have been a result of the Canyon Creek fire, ability of those planted fish, those rainbow trout, those Yellowstone cutthroat trout to recolonize this disturbed area from those lakes, perhaps. That's speculation. But what we have up here is a high elevation rainbow trout hybrid swarm. If you look at all these red lines through, say, Beaver Creek, the upper Landerspoor, those are all pure, genetically pure West Slope cutthroat trout streams. This is a real outlier in the Blackfoot Basin in terms of the distribution of rainbow trout and cutthroat trout. Cabin Creek here. I sampled that, I think, in 2004. We sent the genetics to the lab. Our own Rob Leary wrote this report. What he found was that within that population of cutthroat trout, he found one rainbow trout. There was one rainbow trout in that sample that managed to get up that intermittent reach, ascend Cabin Creek, and we found it. And so what we've learned from that fish is that, you know, they are getting up through that. These fish are getting up into pure cutthroat trout waters up in the Dry Fork. This is an interesting map because it shows distribution of bull trout. They go right to the falls. We do not have bull trout upstream here where we have, you know, West Slope cutthroat genes above the falls. They were clearly up there. Can't say that was the case for bull trout up here. Probably was a natural barrier going back to Aboriginal bull trout colonization days. This is a map showing a climate change prediction model that was just published by Dan Isaac. And what this shows in 1980 is thermally suitable bull trout spawning and rearing habitat is up in that northern mountain range. We're seeing some of it along the margins of the valley, but this is where the real cold water is. You can see the contraction in thermal habitat based on predictions of climate warming right now. And I hope this model is wrong, because the next biologist, if this thing is right, who stands up here in 25 years after coming out of this class, according to this model, we're going to lose our part, you know, thermal habitat for bull trout in the North Fork. You know, one generation away. So, anyway, that's interesting, you know. According to the models, it does not look good for bull trout. Here's a picture of the North Fork. Here's a picture of the Lower Dry Creek. You can see that perched alluvial valley. It's intermittent. This is the burn area looking up valley from the North Fork Falls. Again, this is how you get in it. Get into that country. It's about a 15 to 20 mile ride. We have a trail system. We've got these wilderness cabins that we use, these outfitter camps, and this allows us to get around and do the work that we've done up there. It's pretty nice. There's actually quite a few trails. This is a picture of the North Fork above the falls. The falls is just down here about a half a mile. This is the main East Fork. Okay, so I'm going to go into some of the data now. Again, here's the falls. Here's the main stem North Fork. Here's the East Fork. These are the three lakes. These are the three fishing-bearing lakes that we have up there. So we've been up there. We've done all kinds of studies. We've got the baseline report out if anybody would like to see it. We know what's going on up there. One of the three lakes is Parker Lake, and these are small lakes. We know that it was planted with undifferentiated cutthroat trout in the 40s. And back in the 40s, a cutthroat was a cutthroat. There was nothing like 14 subspecies of cutthroat trout in 1942. Everything was a cutthroat trout. And so what we do know is that we've got Yellowstone cutthroat trout. We do know from the genetics that Yellowstone cutthroat trout were brought up there. And this looks like your classic Yellowstone. This was caught in Parker Lake. If we go to West Twin Lake, planting records show just a brief period of planting. Those fish took with undifferentiated cutthroat. We don't know what cutthroat to put up there. It's a pretty picture of the lake. This is a hybrid rainbow trout. West Slope looks like a West Slope hybrid, okay? And so what this data is really pointing us towards is replacing these hybrids fish, you know, as a native conservation manager to action the native fish. And so here is, you know, a pure cutthroat just over the hill in a place called Heart Lake. And so with this data set, with this hybridization, with high elevation fishery up there, we, you know, this data set is pushing us into the direction, I think, of having a management action up in the wilderness that would replace these hybrids and these rainbow trout with pure fish. Okay. Here's another fish-bearing lake. It's called Meadow Lake. It's more meadow than lake. It's only 3 feet deep. Very few fish in it. The outfitters stocked that one. Oh, gosh. I know they stocked it in the 40s and the 50s, maybe even prior. Okay, let's go into some of the fish population data. We'll start with the East Fork streams. Okay, all of these. And again, we do this with an electrofishing unit. That's me with an electrofishing unit. Larry Peterman's the guy with the net. This guy, we put the fish in there. We anesthetize those fish. We take a tiny fin clip. We get some data. We turn the fish loose. That's how we measure abundance. One of the things that I want to point out is that these catch rates of zero fish to 4.6 fish per 100 feet. These are very, very low catch rates on the main stem of the East Fork. Reference conditions would be anywhere from about 12 to 30 or 40 fish per 100 feet. Sourdough Creek, one of the coldest streams, 0.4 fish per 100 feet. Very, very low numbers of fish. The headwaters are fishless. Very interesting. We were shocked at how few fish we found up there. Mineral Creek, one of the largest tributaries. We have a little higher numbers of fish, but when you get into the headwaters, very, very low numbers of fish. Meadow Creek is one of the larger streams. To me, this looks like ideal spawning conditions. Look at these catch rates. These fish aren't doing very well up there, these hybrid fish. And that's been, you know, they've discovered that in other studies throughout the northern Rockies. Flathead, they're seeing the same thing. These hybrid fish are generally unfit to these types of environments. Looking up into the North Fork tributaries, the North Fork, low numbers of fish. Broda Creek, 2.7 fish per 100 feet, very low. Broadus Creek, catch of 1.2 fish downstream of these falls. Fishless upstream. Cooney Creek, one of the coldest tributaries out there. Look at that, 0 to 0.2 fish per 100 feet. Incredibly low numbers of fish. If this were cutthroat trout water, this thing would be teeming with fish. We just don't see it up there. We think what describes this distribution and this number and these numbers of fish is this basic relationship of temperature. So here we're plotting temperature, maximum annual temperature against the catch for trout, and what we see is when we get to about 53 degrees or so, we get to the point where we don't have any fish. Okay, so these fish really don't do that well. If it weren't for those lakes, they wouldn't be up there. I think the data is clear. This is some principal component analysis looking at genetic diversity across the landscape. And so what I want to point to is these blue bars. This is the pure fish that we have in the hatchery system, which comes out of about a dozen different populations in western Montana. Just south of this area in the North Fork, this sample here in the Beaver Creek drainage follows very closely what we see in the genetic makeup of the hatchery stock. This is from Silver King Falls. This is the nearest neighbor. This is, I think, an aboriginal cutthroat trout population upstream of a very similar geologic falls. And what we see is a completely different, you know, set of genetic variation up in that population. And this is up in the Flathead. And so if we do go into this management action of replacing these fish, you know, it seems to be a big project. We would be looking at these kind of data sets to try to match the right fish to that environment. There's probably some combination of this. This is some temperature data. We're continuously tracking temperature. One thing I want to show you is that look at the variation in summer temperatures up here in the East Fork, okay, at this location, downstream of Parker Lake versus Sourdough Creek, which is right here. Look at the difference. You know, this is ideal bull trout habitat. This is really good productive water for a lot of fish. But this data set shows it in wintertime in Meadow Creek, in Upper Meadow Creek. Here is, look at that, you know, the temperature's warmer than it is down valley, okay, where it's flatlined at 32 degrees. And what this shows is groundwater upwelling. When we get in, we talked about groundwater being 44, 45 degrees. Average temperature, it's a little cooler than that at these higher elevations, but whenever you get this warmer water above these anchorized conditions, it tells you you have groundwater inflows, and that's what bull trout cue into. So we think this area has what it takes to support bull trout. We've done a lot of other surveys up there, and what's interesting about these bug and amphibian surveys, they follow the same pattern in terms of density, abundance as fish do. Warmer waters have more of these little critters. And the same holds true for tail frogs, which are cold water fish, or cold water frogs. This is, remember the reference condition? Okay, here's our last example of the reference condition. Here's what we found in terms of catch per unit effort in the surveys upstream of the falls, the average catch per unit effort for the fish, okay, age one and older fish. This is the reference condition that we found from nearby surrounding streams as we've been monitoring this high elevation environment with just native trout compared to these hybrids. And so, to me, what that, you know, the question is, well, what's that doing to the rest of, you know, these fisheries-dependent ecosystem out there, you know? The fish numbers are so low, you know? What's it mean to the mink or these other, species up in this wilderness environment? Probably not benefiting from the condition of this hybrid swarm. So, to sum it up, this North Fork is a high elevation, it's a pristine setting. It's got lake streams, it's got productivity, it's got very cold streams. Because this thing was planted, gosh, starting 70 years ago, hybrids are spread throughout the system right now. These fish are poorly suited to the environment, they provide low ecological value, and they pose a risk to down valley, west slope cutthroat trout. The stream system, we think, has really high potential for native trout. It may have even very high value for bull trout, especially if these warming trends play out as they're predicted. There's cabins, there's trails, there's things, you know, that we could do this project, I think. It would be a very big project to replace these hybrids with native fish. We think we could do it. And we've got the fish nearby, you know, the native pure stocks nearby if we choose to go in that direction, or if the public, you know, allows us to go in that direction. These are some of the people who helped us collect the data up there. This is our crew from 2014, Forest Service. Like all of our studies, we kind of cobbled this one together, too, with a lot of help. Got my email there in case anybody wants to contact me about anything that we've talked about tonight. I know I threw a lot of stuff at you, but you guys are all smart college kids. I'm sure it's something in, right? You know, it's the nature. This is the nature of fisheries work in Western Montana. I know we got the fisheries class here. We've got EVST. We've got the wilderness folks here. These are all current themes, contemporary themes. Don't forget about the data collection aspect of it. You got to have the data. You have to learn how to collect that data. You have to be trained in that. You have to put it together. I'll try to answer some more questions. How's that? We'll button it up. Vicki?
I want you to applaud. Oh.
Right. What effect is the brook trout had in this whole restoration?
Well, we don't have brook trout above falls. And I'm very glad we don't, because we can probably work with the system. If we had brook trout up there, it would be very, very, very difficult. Brook trout, as a rule, are no friend of the native trout. They seem to do well in upwelling areas, too. They don't venture up valley as far as the bull trout, as a rule. For instance, they're not in the North Fork spawning area, the Copper Creek spawning area. They're a char like the bull trout, so they do need groundwater influence, but their spawning sites, as a rule, are down valley in smaller streams, lower gradient streams. They don't seem to like that energy and those cold temperatures like the bull trout.
Just want to clarify, did you say so no bull trout above the North Fork Falls?
We've not detected them. We can't say that they weren't there. Maybe something happened. But we have not found bull trout above the North Fork Falls in any of our surveys. We found sculpins and Yellowstone, Rainbow, West Slope genes in the hybrid population.
I just wanted to make a really quick announcement, and that's Ron has showed us 30 years of conservation progress on the Blackfoot, for which I'm very grateful. There's an event coming up in April here on campus where we'll be looking at 30 years of conservation progress across the whole Clark Fork Basin. People coming from different parts of the basin to give talks similar to the one that you just gave for other parts of the basin. It's called the Clark Fork Symposium. The first one took place 30 years ago in 1985. We've had one every 5 years since then, and this is another Clark Fork Symposium year. So just Google Clark Fork Symposium and you'll find the program. And there is a special student rate, so don't worry about that.
So I know this is a big question, but can you talk just a little bit about some of the challenges that you run into doing science in a wilderness area?
Oh boy, well, you don't go home at the end of the day, you know. You take all your gear with you, you know, you put it on a pack mule, you manny up and you head to the high country. And so if you forget something or something breaks or, you know, something goes wrong, you have to account for that. It takes a long time to get between sampling locations. We might get two or three samples done a day. Three would be a very good day. When you start out from a base camp, you ride 5 or 6 miles on a horse, you unman, you take all your gear off, you saddle up, you're electroshocking, you know, you do your work, you put it all back onto the mule, and you head another 5 miles to the next site or something like that. It takes years. It's taken us, I think, four or five years to do this work. And we're
You know, we have continuous temperature sensors out there right now, for instance. We're going to do some more lake surveys. We're going to do some more bug surveys and that kind of thing. Everything takes longer. You know, you have to slow right down. You have to learn to eat a lot of trail dust because you're behind these mules and it's dusty and all that kind of thing. I think that's the big thing. There's not much room for error, you know. You know, we've had to make our own solar panel electric, you know, chargers for our backpack units, you know, things like that. So we got it dialed in pretty good. And if this project goes forward, which I don't know if it will or not, it's an idea right now, we'll be taking it to another level and, you know, recognizing there are clearly, you know, constraints to what you can get done in a day.
What would be some benefits of reintroducing bull trout?
I didn't hear that question.
What would be some benefits, or I guess the opposite of benefits?
The benefits, the biological benefits?
Yeah, to reintroducing.
Oh, the okay. Well, one of them, we would address the Down Valley hybridization of pure West Slope cutthroat trout. Okay. You know, if it turned into a bull trout recovery project, you know, it could address, you know, it could get these fish in an area where we'll probably have suitable habitat, where a lot of the current models say, you know, we're not going to have bull trout habitat. So you can, that could be a benefit. I think the ecological benefits are what I come back to. These fish, there's so few fish, and the distribution is only 50%, about 50% of what the perennial stream network is. So fish, few fish up there that, you know, the whole community of fish-eating birds and critters has got to be suppressed up there too. So I think this is a ecosystem level restoration project using fish. I don't think it could be anything else, given the limited distribution and the low numbers of fish up there.
So there aren't very many of those hybrids, but how do you propose to get rid of them? You must have a plan.
Everything is hybrid up there, yeah. Well, we don't have a plan. But if we do develop a plan, what it would do, I think, is involve a piscicide. We'd introduce an organic compound from the root of a bean plant, which has been used for hundreds, maybe thousands of years to harvest fish. It's an organic compound called rotenone, and we would have to use that, and we would kill the fish.
So you'd go to the headwaters of these various streams?
Yeah. And then, you know, reintroduce pure, genetically pure cutthroat trout. That's what the general plan would look like. I have some information here on what that means for anybody who's interested. You know, so grab one of these. Vicki, if your students are interested in any of this, or the fishery students, here's a good summary of what that piscicide is all about. It's been used all over the West for decades. It's very, very commonly used in projects like this.
Does it get food chain, affect anything else?
Not if it's used properly. You use a very small amount of it, breaks down very quickly, it's organic. It's used in organic farms, insecticides, things like that. That's one of the nice things about it. It's not some odd poison. It's, you know, it's from, you know, a legume, and you know, it's once people get over the oh my God, you're going to kill fish thing, you know, and find out what it really is about. You know, there's been a broad level of acceptance. We've not used it in this region, but it's used all over Montana and all over the West. Very common.
Well, I know in the big hole last fall, you were doing a lot of poisoning work in the streams that had natural barriers like that.
Okay, yeah.
So was that what they were using?
I suspect that's what they were using. There's another piscicide out there called antimycin, but I don't think it's available on the market right now.
What are the benefits of replacing the non-native trout with or the native species?
With the native fish? Well, like I said, it's an ecological restoration project as I see it, because of the numbers, the low numbers of fish up there. So,
okay, but below the falls where there's already a fish species
okay.
present, what's the benefit?
Okay, downstream of the falls.
Fish with another
okay.
Fish?
We're picking up Yellowstone, hybridized Yellowstone cutthroat trout tributaries down there. We know these rainbow hybrids are trying to get upstream of the Dry Fork, so there's hybridization questions. I think if we can, and this is a personal opinion of mine, if we can turn this community back over to native trout upstream, then we'll see a lot more fish spilling over the falls. It will become a recruitment source for native trout in the headwater areas, just like all the other functional tributaries are. And so I think they would come over the falls in much higher abundance. I think that, you know, you'd be better bull trout forage, you'd be better heron, you know, prey base, eagles, osprey, mink, garter snakes, all of that kind of stuff. I think if it's done right, that could be a great, it could be a great native trout conservation project, and it would address a number of issues, ecological issues, hybridization issues, heck, probably be better fishing. Vicki.
Whose decision would it be? I assume there'd be both federal and state agencies involved in making this.
Yeah, I think it'd be a public decision. You know, this is a big project. It would go through, you know, a public process for sure, you know, if the public got behind it, just like the Blackfoot River Restoration Project, you know, it would likely go forward if for some reason the public says, you know, we don't like it, probably wouldn't go forward. So ultimately, that's where the decision, I think, is going to be made with the public. But, you know, the FWP is a trustee of the resource. The Forest Service is a trustee. We're talking to the Forest Service about this. They've seen this presentation, and we'll see where it goes. It's going to happen. Those decisions are going to be made at higher levels, you know, at the regional office, the highest levels in our outfit. You know, it's a big project. It's bigger than our regional fisheries resources, our people, our operations budget can absorb. We can't do that project. We would have to pull in experts. And, you know, it'd have to be a priority for the state of Montana, fisheries division, you know. And so, you know, it's, yeah, it's, I don't know exactly where all the decisions would be made, but, you know, certainly through the NEPA process and the environmental review process and the public scoping and all of that other stuff would be a very large part of it.
Can you clarify historic conditions of those upstream reaches? Because a couple of times you referred to reintroduction of native trout species or turning it back over to the native species. What were the historic conditions before the hybrid trout were stocked?
Yeah, great question. And I don't think we know that answer. We can't tell from our surveys exactly what that historical condition was. We do know that native cutthroat, native west slope were up there. We do know that.
You know that.
Well, the genetic information says that they were there. We don't know if they were aboriginal or brought in or both. Okay. We have historical accounts from some of the old timers that say cutthroat fishing was really good in the 40s and the 50s. We do know that Yellowstone were brought in. That's a non-native fish. And we do know that rainbow were brought in. We found sculpins up there, which is interesting. You know, I don't think those fish would have been brought in. But, you know,
it's
whether...
considerable if they could navigate the falls.
I don't think it's possible, personally. That I would learn something about fish if that were the case, for sure. I can't tell you beyond that. You know, I've asked the geneticists that same question, and they can't tell me the genetic samples. You know, we have a 100-year time period in there, but we don't really know what happened up there. Even where we do have the records, you know, the cutthroat trout weren't differentiated by subspecies. And so, all I can say is the genes are up there. And we don't know exactly, you know, if they were there prior to human intervention, were brought in, or like I say, maybe both.
I think from a wilderness context, that would be a key question that we have to answer.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it would be really nice if we had information go back into the 30s, the 40s, 50s, whatever it was, but these are the first fisheries investigations ever up there. Yeah. It's pretty fuzzy. History is fuzzy in my mind. I've gone through, I've interviewed as many old-timers as I can find. I've scoured through the historical records that I can find, and record-keeping was very, very poor in those days, non-existent in many cases. I don't know if there was, we didn't find, I didn't find any records of rainbow stocking in the lakes. It had to happen.
In the North Fork system above the falls, are there enough other significant fish barriers that would make it really feasible for treatment? Or would you guys have to place in some barriers?
Yeah, there are a couple of them, but there's not very many. So if a treatment like this did occur, you know, it would have to be highly coordinated, sequenced down valley, you know, using block nets and that kind of thing. Yeah, it's not like something like Cherry Creek where they had all these, or certain other large projects like this where we had all these nice little barrier falls that they could see this project. That's not going to be the case.
Are the aquatic insects, are there enough in abundance to support the trout population?
I think so. You know, I think, you know, there's going to be a lot of terrestrials. I think the temperature is ideal for bull trout. You know, not that they're going to be there in high abundance. There's going to be places where the productivity is much higher. Secondary productivity is much higher, and I think, you know, there would be more fish, just like we're seeing in that regression that I showed you. One of the things that we do know about these West Slope cutthroat trout, and that gets back to the reference condition, that these are headwater specialist fish. They do really, really well in small streams, and the fish that we have up there don't do very well. And one of the reasons that I think West Slope do well, and anybody who fishes West Slope cutthroat trout knows this, is that they eat anything that looks like food. You know, I mean, that's how it is when you have gone, you know, evolved into unproductive streams. And so, you know, if it looks like something that's edible, they're gonna make a move on it. So that doesn't mean that there's gonna be uniform or, you know, densities across the area. That isn't gonna be the case. There'll be places with lower productivity and areas with higher productivity. But I do think that we're gonna have, you know, a distribution which is almost double what we saw if we go with native cutthroat trout.
Well, thank you, Ron, for closing out our series this semester. Really appreciate you coming.
Thanks for having me.